Hello everyone, welcome to Conversations. This is the January 7th weekend and we are recording our thoughts.
Yes, welcome. This is our first podcast for the year 2023. So I think today this is kind of an interesting weekend, a reflective weekend, and probably a somewhat emotional weekend for you, and probably some reasons why, if you'd like to share.
Yes, the positive thing is that 6th January is Kapil Dev's birthday. For those of you who know cricket, you know that he's a legendary cricketer from India. It's also the birthday, today is 7th of January, it's also the birthday of Anshu Jain. For those of you who are in investment banking would know that he was a global superstar and the first Indian CEO of Deutsche Bank, which is a very rare achievement. And Anshuman passed away in August of last year, and he was a childhood friend. So the last 3 to 4 years, Kapil and Anshuman used to celebrate their birthdays together. And it's a bit emotional because this is the first birthday where I have not been able to wish Anshuman. You know, he was a teenager when he actually introduced me to Kapil, because he was also trying to be a cricketer and they had the same coach. Kapil was a few years older. And that was my first sports interview as a teenage woman sports journalist. So I was joking with Kapil that he was the first fast bowler superstar and I was the teenage first woman sports journalist in India. Anshuman was sick for the last 5 years, defied all the odds, and again reconnected me with Kapil, because I've been living in the U.S. for the last almost close to 4 decades. And, you know, there were no, once I moved here in 84, there were no, there was no internet. Phone calls were very expensive. Kapil is not much of a letter writer, so it's not like I kept in touch with everybody. Some of the cricketers did write to me, but then that kind of slowly dwindles away when you get busy with your own life. So about 2 years ago, Anshuman reconnected me with Kapil, because I would always ask him about how Kapil is. And he surprised me, I think, in March of 2021 from a golf course and said, I have a surprise for you. And Kapil was standing behind and we reconnected. And, you know, Kapil came back into my life at a time when I'd lost my father and I was about to lose my mother in 11 months. And he's been really such a positive influence in my life, having known me, you know, the longest. He met me when I was 18. He has this wonderful way of putting things in perspective, and he really is one of the best friends that you can have in your corner. You have met him, you know, recently, not knowing much about cricket, but I'm sure you found him as personable as I always say he is.
Yes, I think both of these individuals, you've known for quite a while, and your association with both of them goes back to your adolescence and teenage years. And so it's always interesting to hear about perspectives from folks that know your significant other from a very long time ago. But you're right, I didn't know much about cricket. I still don't. I think a couple of months ago, a couple of years ago, you could probably take everything I knew about cricket and fill a teaspoon and still have room for a teaspoon worth of something. So I didn't actually have much knowledge. But I think the movie 83 was probably instrumental in at least understanding the man, at least, you know, in his youth. And, you know, while I don't know much about cricket, I am a big fan of sports movies and underdog stories. And it was really interesting to watch that film in a packed hall. And many people probably knew about cricket and knew about the team and the history, but it was a historic victory for India, and it was a huge underdog story. And for me, what is interesting about any underdog story, it doesn't matter if you know the sport or not. I think a lot of people probably weren't that fond of boxing, but Rocky was a huge hit, and a lot of people really identified with you know, the underdog story there. This movie was no different. And, you know, motley crew of characters, a lot of different diverse backgrounds on that 83 India team. And the job of the captain and the coach is really to take this diverse group of people and, you know, string them together to basically be the straw that stirs the drink into a winning cocktail. So it was very interesting to see a young man, you know, coming into his own, Kapil Dev, in that movie, and the way he kind of motivated everyone and pulled everybody together, very diverse backgrounds, you know, religious backgrounds, etc., and really pulled together a historic victory on British soil for India.
Yeah, so. That's very true. And also that he was very young, he was just 24, and the Indian cricket did not have a reputation of keeping their captains for long periods of time so that they get the experience and the knowledge of the players who are playing, you know, under them, and how to motivate them. And also language was another barrier. You know, Kapil didn't speak English. There were many other people who didn't speak Punjabi or English. There were South Indian players. And so how he motivated them was with his own spirit. And, you know, when I met him, he was a quiet guy, very focused on what he wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And I see that stubbornness and that indomitable spirit now in his 60s turn into great positivity. And, you know, he's now somebody who didn't talk at all, was made fun of because he didn't know English, was called names behind his back as being dumb, is now a very sought-after speaker in big business circles, among students, you name it. And he just owns the space when he walks in. He doesn't care that if his English doesn't sound like somebody who's from Oxford, but he definitely conveys the message that he wants to give. And the reason why I finally decided to have this conversation with him and share it with the audience is because people have been asking me for the last almost 3 years, like, can you please interview Kapil Dev? And that was not because he's a cricket legend, but because I'd started sharing some of his thoughts on life lessons, and why, you know, we should be the way we should be. And so I decided that this is as auspicious a time as any, although I was joking with him that I'm giving everybody else a present on his birthday by sharing this conversation with them. And like I said, I never do interviews. People say, you know, you're a journalist interview. I have conversations. They are candid, they're respectful, they're fun. And I hope that this particular one will inspire people to be better versions of themselves. And also, this is not going to be the first one in what is going to be a series, hopefully ongoing series with him. There are so many things I discover about him every day. And something that happened related to Anshuman made me realize, it happened on Friday on Kapil's birthday, made me realize that he's also a man of his word. And that I will share when I share a tribute and my thoughts about Anshuman Jain, you know, to commemorate his 60th birthday, which is today, the 7th of January.
So I think we'll all be looking forward to that, and looking forward to your conversations with Kapil Dev. And we'll start with this one.
Yes, thank you for listening.
Thank you.
All right, so happy birthday, and all the very best for a very long innings, healthy innings, and happy innings. It's great to talk to
you. Thank you very much.
Last year you had just friends deliver some food for you because of COVID. How was the birthday this year?
I think it's wonderful. Once you reach at this age, every day is a birthday, but it's different. And whenever your four friends sit, you can celebrate that birthday.
You know, I actually wanted the people who follow you since I started talking about, you know, your thoughts and the way you look at life. People have known you as this legendary cricketer. So everybody kind of got hooked on to what, you know, the way you approach life, the way you look at things. And so I thought I'll give these people a nice birthday present by having a conversation about life.
Well, I'll give my love to everybody. I mean, you know, it doesn't matter how big star or whatever your achievement is. Nothing is can recognize, if people don't recognize what you have done, that. So you feel very happy and proud if people love you.
Yeah.
And that give me happiness. People, after so many years, still, you know, remember you. Everybody has an ability, but somebody's ability, other people love it. You really feel happy about that.
Kapil, COVID has really changed everything in people's lives. At what point did you realize that this was serious business?
I think I take it that it's a learning. COVID was a thing happened, whichever, whoever done, whatever way it was. I thought it was the biggest learning. I didn't take it as a negative. Yes, I'm lucky I'm survived. A lot of people, a lot of close one, I'm not really survived. So one can say luck was on our side. Somebody who tried very hard, they didn't survive. So it's a learning. People talk after 1,000 years also how the people survived during the COVID. They will give example of people like us. So everybody who survived, it was a tough time, but it was a learning. I take it as a positive side. It was the biggest learning. You have to stay home. You have to do your own work. You have to love the people whom you are very close to. You start talking to somebody whom you never ever met for so many days. You had so much spare time. I think one had to understand everything is not the way Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. It is a sometime different time comes, which you have to take it in your stride. And a lot of people were not happy about that, but I always say, no man, it's learning time for us. If ever things come out like this, how we have to survive, look after each other.
I remember you were delivering food at one time. You had called me and you were sending, taking, you were in your car and you said you were going to deliver some food to friends. And you were looking in Delhi, looking around you. And I think that was how we were all kind of surviving, just being careful, but at the same time helping each other out.
So many people are people like us. We have a domestic help. We close our house. Nobody can come in. Nobody can go out. And some of the people didn't have that also. So I used to pick up the food. The friend of mine who gone through COVID, I used to deliver the food, a simple food, on their gate. So you don't meet each other. The norm was like that. You have to stay from each other. We used to put the food outside their door and come back. And that's how we try to help each other. The tough time was that when there were nobody was taking the body of people who died. I think that was very sad. You really feel bad about that. Why? Even the close one, the kids not taking their parents' body, and it was a tough time, but we have to learn, and some of the people turn out to be the greatest human being who come forward and try to help each other. So you come to know the character. End of the day, the character is more important than anything else. Character build the nation, character build everything in the world.
That's
So I
very
thought
true.
it was a learning thing, beautiful in a way.
So, I've known you since I was a teenager, and you were I always mentioned the rising superstar. You were a first. India's first fast bowler, and I was the teenage girl who became India's first woman sports journalist. What I noticed about you at that time was this, you were quiet, you didn't talk a lot, but you were very focused on what you were doing. Today, when I see you, you are one of the most sought after speakers, and you talk about life. And I had mentioned to you the story that my nephew was talking to somebody and he saw, your picture with my nephew, and he asked my nephew if you about you. And then he said to him that there was a business deal that he did with you, or somebody he knew did with you, and it changed their life in just the way you approached it. You've gone through your ups and downs. You lost your father when you were a teenager yourself, and you told me this very touching story that even after your parents had to restart their life again, and even after there was so much affluence in the family, your mother was still very simply dressed all the time. She won't even touch some of the expensive things you got for her. So growing up, were you always this positive? You know, 83 is talked about, the World Cup is talked about, it was your determination, and you know, you led by example, you were very young. But what was your personality like growing up? And today, you know, when you look back at your life, what were the characteristics, you know, that you learned as a child that stood you well as an adult and as a young cricketer who didn't come from a very famous family of sports people?
I think your character and your life keep on changing. Every day something happened and your thought process changed. You can't say the way you were 16 going to be in 30, the way you think 30, you can't be 60. But certain things remain with you throughout your life. And that you don't have to change. I think if you don't change that, that make all the difference. But if the change is required, one have to change time to time,
Yeah, but what was the
I
character?
would say.
What did you learn from your parents, you know, growing up? You must have seen something as parents teach by example. And so you were also amongst, you know, the second youngest in the family, right, of seven siblings?
Yes, but I left home very early, age of 16 or something. I start playing, I start moving. Then I didn't really spend that much time at home.
Right.
80% I was playing cricket. 80% of the day I was playing cricket. So it was not, I can say, I remained there so much, but my job was traveling and learning. One thing I decided in my life is I want to learn every day something new. And that's how this has happened. A lot of people say you played cricket and you know everything. No, there is a world to learn, and cricket is the only ability God gave me, little more than other people. But other people are much more intelligent and sensible. So you have to go out and learn and make your own personality or own life.
So there was a lack of ego then. You mean you were, I think, yeah, that stubbornness of to succeed became, you know, a positive attitude towards life. Because what I see you today, you know, you have helped me so much in terms when, you know, I lost both my parents, and you were so positive and optimistic and just put things in a very different perspective. But of course, to succeed as a fast bowler in a country that had never seen any, requires a lot of grit and determination and stubbornness. But then that seems to have turned into this really positive energy that you exude all the time. And it's not like you haven't had your ups and downs. How do you do that? Because the reason I'm asking this question is I see so many depressed and sad people, especially post-COVID. It's like people have lost the ability to be positive. You know, what are the tips that you can give us all?
I think I don't think that way. I just like to live the life as simple as possible. My job was only one thing. Once you taste the chocolate, you always want to have that. And I tasted the life rather than anything else, a very high standard of life. Traveling on plane, living on 5-star, and maintaining that is not easy. So I would say only way you can, remain the same is you keep on learning more. And if you're learning and you are keep your eyes and ears open all the time, you will reach where you want to reach. If not there, still you are learning.
I think I remember reading a quote where you said that I never wanted to take autographs, I wanted to give them. So for that, you have to achieve something. And, you know, when you're growing up, everybody will help you reach the top. But when you start coming, you know, start reaching that status, then, you know, people try to pull you down, the same people who try to raise you. So it's not like the path is that easy where you can just focus.
Yeah, but path is not that difficult if you are sincere with yourself, not with other people, yourself. First, you have to learn to be honest to yourself. then path is not difficult. It's just you have to work. I always say that. Yes, ready to give rather than to take. For that, you have to work. That's what I tell the school kids. I say, don't take autograph, give autograph. And for that, you have to achieve something. I go to the school and colleges, still say one thing. I said, just try to work hard and don't try to, you know, lie to yourself. Mostly whatever happened, the kids want to show to other people. Today, I mean, I give you example, people take a selfie when I go for lecture or something. And I get annoyed, you know, you're taking selfie, you're taking a photograph, but you're not here in this room. You want to send it to somebody. They want to impress other people. I said, impress yourself. Other day, my friend went to Mauritius and he was sending a photograph of the beaches and food and crab and all those, you know, drinks and sending to everybody. So I just felt, I said, no, this is a very personal photograph. So many people can't go there. Are you trying to say, ki, I can afford it, you can't afford it? So don't show to certain people. One example I can give you is when I start going to give training to the young kid. And I said, in a very innocent manner, I said, khaya piya karo, doodh piya karo, you know, you will become strong. And after a week, a kid's mother came to me and she said, aap kaise keh dete ho kuch bhi ho, ki doodh piya karo. So I didn't feel anything wrong in that. So that lady come to me. Sorry, I'm having my tea also.
That's okay. People will hear you sipping your tea. It's a conversation. It's an organic conversation.
Awesome. Yeah, and that lady said, you know, where I will get the milk? You people come out and say so openly, doodh piya karo. And his son was asking for the milk. Because I said, no, you don't know how other people react, how other people see that. And I said, in future, I learn, I will never say, doodh piya karo. And I said, whatever your mom gives you, eat and drink.
So as you said, we learn all the time with each conversation.
Yeah. So you learn these type of things. It's not whatever you say or the other people. You are not in other people's shoes. After that, almost, how many, 20 years, I never said to any kid, I said, khaya piya karo jo mom deti hai.
So one thing I keep hearing about you is, you know, your generosity and, you know, and this is from people who are extremely wealthy. They keep telling me Kapil is the most generous person we've met in our life.
When I start playing cricket, there were two, three, one was Rotary, one another organization. In class of ninth, I used to get 300 rupees as scholarship. That was, I could say, this charity to me. And so I can go and play cricket. They were giving me charity to play cricket. So I learn from that very beginning, you have to help each other. And that's what it happened. If I can help somebody, why not? Because somebody helped me when I was growing up.
you found out only not very long ago, not when you were a child, that you had dyslexia. And I see that Kushi, your the non-profit that you have founded, actually helps young children, underprivileged children, come up to par if they are weak in some kind of subjects. And how did Kushi come about the idea of having a non-profit?
My Rakhi sister, she has a son who is, I would say, 80%, 85% fine, but one side of his, while born, he didn't develop. And she was the one who started. And one day they said, we should try to help them out. I said to Harveen, I said, Harveen, collecting money is no problem. Utilizing of money is very, very important. I said, people in this world are very kind also, who give money. But 90% organization don't spend the money on the right direction. I said, I'll collect the money. But if more than 85% or 85% money should go to the charity, whatever the charity you are doing, I'll collect the money. That's how the start. I said, the way corporate work, you have to work like that. 15% you can spend on the administration, whatever way. 85% money will come, have to go to the charity. And that's how Khushi comes out. And I said, I'm still being very proud. It's 19, 20 years old organization. And two things I said, nobody will remain in a place more than 3 years. Maximum 2 years, you can give grace or can be secretary, president, or anybody. I said, you have to change. So that's few things I put in because I was always against that. Anybody cannot be in one position more than a given time. When you are saying honorary job should not last more than given period of time. And we said, they said, okay, fine. I said, I don't like to see the books. I don't want to see the books, but if you spend 16% of the money what it comes, we will see all the books. So earn more, you can spend more. And that's the way it should be. And it's almost 20 years now. Always we say that one thought process is kept us going in the Khushi is 85% money have to go to charity. Now charity comes out only that ki you there are you can bring a smile on people's face. Everybody is different. So I used to get very happy to see the young kids. Once I was driving on the traffic lights, the young kids come out. He said, Baba, paisa do na. I said, Gaadi mein baitho, mere ghar mein gaadis hai, garden hai, tum usko saaf karo, aur paisa dunga. But he ran away because that's the easy money they are getting. So we have to allocate the job for these people who are the begging in India. I'm not saying in America may be a different thing, but in India we have to do certain things if people believe that that's right.
I mean, but there was also, there was this young boy who came to, was trying to sell flowers, and my sister told me, don't give him too much money because he may be part of a gang and they may hurt him or something. It is just a very complex situation there where you try to help these kids. I just hear all these stories. So one doesn't know which charity to lend your hand to or what, these children, what are they all about?
Yeah, so when you're giving money, you must try to find out who they are, what they are. And I believe, genuinely believe, there are lots and lots of people who are there to help other people. But they don't have a time, they don't have a system where to go. So if you make a organization which can help other people, why not? And again, charity, you don't have to force somebody. They should feel within yourself. And I used to enjoy doing that.
So one very interesting thing that I've been told repeatedly is that the older generation, like people like Ratan Tata, and in that generation, those groups of people and the corporates were extremely charitable. They took care of their employees. But the younger generation doesn't seem to be as charitable. What has been your experience? Because you deal with a lot of young people.
One thing you understand, world is changing. You can't say what 100 years back or 1,000 years back used to be pattern, we should do that. No. Everybody is different. The world is changing. You have to change with the world. But if we can keep certain things to remind the youngster, this is the way it should be. Tradition is always beautiful. People used to, in olden days, somebody come to your house, they used to give a food. So it's all depend. New generation have to think their way. And we don't have to force them. I don't ever believe force the new generation.
But do you think that the new generation is different? You know, you said something, and please correct me if I'm wrong, because when I do research, you know, a lot of times people are misquoted. But you said that when it comes to business, for example, you like the slow and steady growth approach and not like quick fixes. And it seems to me, at least what I see of the younger generation, both in America as well as in India, a lot of them are competing too hard and trying to take shortcuts to success. And as a result, they're becoming very unhealthy. I see very young people having heart attacks and very stressed out, depression, taking antidepressant pills and stuff like that. So what is your thought? Because you advise all these people, you're a very sought after speaker in business circles.
No, I say to them, if one person become very successful, yes, you follow. But you don't have to look in all only to him. You have to look at the system. If one person becomes Sachin Tendulkar, everybody can't. But we should try to play the game in the best manner. But one person in the business makes so much money, everybody want to follow him. And following that person is fine. Then taking the path is very important. Which path you are taking, how much hard work he's done. You don't see that. You only see how many millions or billions of dollars this young man in such a short age had made. But you haven't seen how much research and how much time he's put into that business. So we see the final product. We don't see the hard work. And then the people, I'm not so lucky. Then the depression comes. So we always say, everybody can't become Sachin Tendulkar, or everybody can't become Gavaskar. But there's so many people can play for the country. That's more important. Everybody can't become Tata. Everybody can't become Ambani. But we can do the business one day. Time will come if we can jump. But you want these days, young generation want to jump one step to 100 step directly. And there is a chance you will fall down. And then what happened? That depression comes, things will come. The things are not right for me. They start talking negative. So I said, take a step by step. Reaching on top is fine, but you have to take two steps at a time to reach on 100th floor.
So as a cricketer, what are the experiences that you've had that you have utilized in your life? The cricket lessons that you learned, and you've had a long span as a cricketer. What are the things that you learned as a cricketer that you brought to life lessons?
One thing you can't. You go to the cricket ground every day, you think you want to make 100, but you don't make 100. But your idea is, I want to go and get runs. I want to go and get wickets. So every day we learn There is a failure, there is a success, there is a failure, there is a success. That's why the sports people take the life is much easier, because we see the zeros and 100 every second day or every alternative day. There is a time when we make a zero, there is a time. Even best of the best player don't make 100 every day.
Right.
But we take success and loss in a very simple manner. Yes, there is another day for us. Let's work hard. Working hard will give you more better result.
So I will ask you two more questions and I'll let you go. And I hope this is only the first of our many conversations. We talk to you almost every other day and I always learn something from you. So my first question, I have to ask something about 83, otherwise people will not be happy with me. I know that initially you didn't want to make this movie because you felt you were very young. You were only 24 and, you know, at that time your character is not developed. Then your condition was, from the interview I read with Kabir Khan, that everybody must be given equal importance. You know, the players who were there must be honored as a team. And so was there anything that surprised you about 83 when it came out? I think it's going to be a cult classic in times to come. What surprised me, I went and saw it first day first show in Boston. It was full. I saw like 13 and 12-year-old kids sitting in the theater, and they were not Punjabis. They were not from Haryana. They were from Gujarat and Tamil Nadu and, you know, other states of India. And to see such young kids was very exciting for me. I, of course, cried because I knew all the players, you know, and certain things that I saw there, I'd seen them actually happening. So real life experiences. But was there anything that surprised you after you saw the movie and the reaction of people to it?
No, not really. I think in 3 hours, you can't cover up 1,000 hours. You can't cover up in 3 hours. But I think given if you look back, I think they've done a fabulous job. If I'm critical, I would say that I don't find many things. It's close to the truth what happened.
Mm.
A director or producer have to do a little bit more dramatic than what we, you know, done that. But I think we were a bunch of people who tried our best to play positive cricket more than anything else. And that only thing I would say I was happy they showed in the movie was all positive. Mm. And that's what we were. There were a few boys where they shown that they were having fun. But 99% was the way we played the game and that story we said. The best part about this movie was we never sat together and we decided everybody will give his side of the story. If all of us sit together, sometimes some people influence other person in the team. But let everybody give their side of the story. So everybody spent time with Kabir Khan and his team. And I given my side of the story. I remember this. And Sunil remember this. Dilip remember this. Kirti Adad. But certain people are much in a group, in a team, are bigger who like to tell the stories and who remember the stories. Mm. But certain people don't remember the stories after 30, 40 years. But that's why we enjoyed this movie. And I can say the detailing what their team done was fabulous. And even to the laces, even to the somebody wearing a black thread in the neck, they had that also. So I thought it was pretty, pretty good. And when you talk about yourself, you can't really criticize too much. But if I look at critical side, I would say, you know, had they done everybody the way they did my role, all the other actor also, they put it very close. It would have been different, but then everybody have to see how much money they have and things like that.
Right. Well, that's why I said that I wish this would have been made into a web series, because then you can explore the characters and so many different incidents that happened, you know, much, in much more detail. But I don't think Ranveer Singh could have kept up that physique for a web series for that long. But I think he did a pretty remarkable job, you know, to imitate and be a living legend who's right there and people can see. And by the way, that was very smart. You didn't even tell me that you were going to be in the movie. I screamed like everybody else when I saw you in the stands catching that catch. I had no idea you were in the film. And, you know, as yourself and, of course, Mohinder as Lala Amarnath, it was a very special moment for me. But, you know, what was really interesting about this film, people who knew nothing about cricket, you know, they, like my husband, for example, he knows nothing about cricket. He's raised here in America. But he said he loved the story because it was a story of of underdogs triumphing. And you know that young boy, my dad's driver's grandson, who fought with his father and said, "I want to join a cricket academy. I want to be like Kapil Dev." I had, you know, introduced him to you, and you chatted, and he was so excited. So I think this is what has come out of this film, that this renewed interest and love and patriotism that young children are feeling now that they want to play for their country. I think that has been such a great thing about 83.
I think everybody loved cricket. The only thing is they never seen, the young kid never seen something what we achieved 40 years back. So connectivity was very easy because what I come to know in meeting people is the grandfather and father talking about to the kids. In our time, the cricket was different. Suddenly they all sit together and they watch the movie. I think that's where the young generation, oh, okay, Papa was talking about this, and Grandpa was talking about that. That's why this movie went into everybody's home, because they can relate, parents can relate with the kids can relate with the parents, because whatever the story you tell when you see on the screen, and I would say parent will come out, no, this is going to happen like this, and the kid get charged. That's what it happened in this movie. When they sit together and watch a grandchildren, father and great grandfather all sit together, and their moms and sister, no, you don't know, this is what happened.
Right.
And I think that's what this movie become much more household name.
It's also unifying a lot of people because otherwise all everybody's doing is watching their, staring at their phones and text messaging and whatever. But this is people are coming together. It used to be like that when Ramayan was going to be played on every Sunday morning and, you know, a long time back. So this has become the swan song. Kapil, thank you so much. It's always a pleasure talking to you. You're one of the most authentic, genuine, kind, caring people I know. I'm very blessed to have you in my life, and I hope this little segment of my conversation with you will also give people a glimpse
No,
into who you are.
give everybody a happy new year and a great life, and tell everybody life is for living, not for cribbing.
That's
Life
awesome.
is for living, not for cribbing.
That's so
And
wonderful.
God have given us life, why not live the life?
Thank you so much. And this is only the first of our conversations. Hope, looking forward to many more. Lots of love. Thank you.
All right. Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, that was a really interesting and enjoyable conversation between you and Kapil Dev, Kavitaji. And my initial thoughts were it's always interesting to hear the perspectives of someone who has been through leadership, has really dealt with negativity, but combated it with a lot of positivity. And really, a lot of the same types of attitudes were apparent in the movie 83. And I really enjoyed his perspective on the movie, but even more so, you know, his perspectives on charity and just how to better yourself daily as a human being and how to keep improving.
I think one of the things that hasn't changed about him is his humility. You know, he's when you met him, you know, you cannot even think that he's this great legend, because I remember we were going to meet at a restaurant and I asked him, do you need security? Because he said, I'll just drop in. And I was going to tell my nephew to arrange for a security guard for him. And he burst out laughing. He just guffawed and walked into the restaurant by himself. People were really shocked when they saw him there, but everybody was very respectful. So he commands that respect and came up to him for autographs. But I think what really sets him apart is his ability to utilize his fame to help people feel better about themselves, to make a difference in every single way that he can. And I think that's what makes him special. I'm really blessed to have him in my life, because when my mother passed away, you know, you knew my mom, so you were, of course, dealing with your own sadness of her passing. And it was Kapil who would call and check on me every single day, gave me space when I needed space, put things in perspective for me as to why I should be grateful that I had my mother in such great health for as long as I did, and that she lived to see great-grandchildren. I even said to him one time, I wish I could get the last 30 years of my life back. And he said, don't ever say that. Say that may the next 30 years of my life be great ones. And, you know, he ended the conversation with giving everybody his love, but he said, just remember, life is for living, not for cribbing. And I think many of us can really, you know, learn to incorporate that in our lives. We often focus on what we don't have, then count our blessings and be grateful for what we have.
Yeah, that is so true. And I just wanted to echo what you said about him being a warm and genuine human being, because, again, I didn't know much about his background, but, you know, the day I met him, I just remember him being extraordinarily warm and very kind and very down to earth. And, you know, I shook his hand and he kind of pulled me aside and, you know, he kind of jokingly said, does she, pointing to you, talk so much at home? And I remember saying, no, she saves that all for you. And he laughed and, you know, kind of patted me on the back. But I liked him immediately. And I'm sure I'm not alone there.
Yeah, he's a very patient listener, because I was always a chatterbox around him, and he's still the same way. And he really listens. It's not like he's tuning out when you're saying anything, even if you're babbling. You know, he really pays attention to what you're saying. That's a great quality to have. I think, like I said, I'm just very blessed to have him as a friend. You know, anybody whose path crosses his would feel the same way.
I can only agree, and looking forward to more conversations in the series with him.
Yes, and that will happen soon. So on this note, we will end this podcast. It's a little longer, but worth every bit of the words exchanged.
Thanks again. Thanks for listening.